Hello everyone, welcome back to another episode of Introductory Organic Chemistry. I apologize if my voice sounds different today, I have a bit of a cold going on right now. So, today we're going to primarily talk about how to name substituted aromatic rings as well as the numbering and nomenclature of alkanes, alkenes, and alkynes. But before we get into that, let's get through the practice questions from last time, as well as the introduction of a couple new functional groups. So last time, I gave you three different sugar derivatives to try and identify ketals, acetals, and related functional groups. Here we have glucose, and you can see there's an ether linkage and an OH to the same carbon, and therefore that's a hemiacetal. Because there's a CH coming off here that we haven't drawn that's implied, that makes it an acetal rather than a ketal. If we look at lactose, you can see that this OCO bond also makes up an acetal. On this carbon, which is the acetal carbon, there's a CH pendant, again, which is why it's not a ketal. In addition, on this this chain, we have an OH and a CO, which makes this a hemiacetal because there's no other carbons off coming off of it. If we look at the nucleotide here, cytidine, we have a hemiaminal ether because there's an OR, some R group coming off, as well as an N with something connected to it, as well as like an CH. But in the case of aminals, we don't distinguish between like acetals and ketal derivatives. Just all of them are considered aminals. Okay, so let's introduce a couple new functional groups. So we haven't talked about ureas, thiourureas, guanidines, or thioamides, but they're very present throughout products, present in consumer products, as well as in compounds that you'll see as we go through this material. I've also included here an anti-cancer drug, which possesses a urea motif within it. And so whether there's NHs or there's R groups coming off of the nitrogens, we still call them ureas, thiourureas, or guanidines, etc. So they can be substituted, but for simplicity, I've just drawn them as NH derivatives here. So getting into the material from today, ring substituents and nomenclature. So when we talk about substituents on benzene rings, we generally talk about them in reference to one functional group. So whatever the R group is, X is relative to that. So when the two position of the benzene ring has a substituent and the one position has a substituent, we call that ortho. When the one and the three position have substituents, we call that meta. And when the one and the four position have substituents, we call that para. The relationship is between these substituents. And so if we had some other substituent, the relationship between them would be different, but between R and X, it's either ortho, meta, or para in these cases. So in this case, we have 2,6-ditert-butyl-4-methylphenol. And so between the 1 and the 2 position, this is ortho. The 1 in the 6 position is also ortho because it's equidistant relative to the phenol. So the phenol and the tert butyl are ortho. If we look at the phenol and the methyl, because this is the 1 position and the 4 position, that makes them para. The tert butyls are two carbons apart, so that makes them meta, and they're also meta to the methyl group. Okay, so some NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, just so happen to possess the different substitution patterns. So here we can see aspirin has an ortho substitution pattern, ibuprofen has a para substitution pattern, and fenoprofen has a meta substitution pattern. And so if you ever are struggling to remember them, you could just draw these three out. Fenoprofen's a little bit obscure, but it works for this example. So when you want to start talking about numbering, you might wonder, where do you start numbering? Like if you have a big substituent, maybe you just want to give it the number one, but it doesn't work that way. So generally what we try to do is we'll alphabetically label the substituents on the ring. So it doesn't go based off of atomic number, like it did in the case of EZ alkene nomenclature. In this case, for benzene rings, it goes alphabetically. So we'll get back to that in a second. So what we want to do as the biggest priority is have the smallest sum possible. So if we'd started counting at bromine, we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That would give us 1, 2, that's 3. 3 plus 5 is 8. So that would give us a sum of 8. Here, if we look at starting with the chlorine in the one position, we have 1, 2, 3, 4. 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 plus 4 is 7. That would give us the lowest overall number, hence naming is started at the chlorine substituent. Now, in this case, if it's possible to do it alphabetically, then the preference would go to the earliest letter in the alphabet. So in this case, bromo. So you have 1 bromo, 2 chloro, 3 ethyl, 4 fluoro, 5 iodo, 6 methyl benzene. The other thing I want to point out here is the order that you list the substituents is done alphabetically, even if the numbering is done in a different order, which is why this example on the left here, we can see even though chloro is the first substituent, we list it second because B comes before C. So the bromo substituent gets listed first, even though it is substituted in the two position of the benzene ring. And for the nomenclature of a lot of molecules, it's less important because these names can be generated using ChemDraw or related software. It's more important to be able to look at molecules and identify motifs, functional groups, such as benzene rings, aryl halides, etc. That's probably the main focus. Most of the time when we need to name these, we wouldn't do them by hand. We would just use convert them from structures to names using software. So as practice questions for next lecture, it would be good for you guys to go over these three practice problems, determine what their substitution pattern is, and also assign them an IUPAC name. Next, we're going to talk about numbering and naming hydrocarbons. Most of the time, like I was just illustrating, you wouldn't rely on your own skills to determine the names. You'd usually use software to generate these for you. However, it's also good to be able to talk about the names to some degree on your own, with your own wit and knowledge. So it's still good to have at least some fundamental knowledge of how the naming system works, even though it's far too complex for any one person to do perfectly. So imagine we have this alkane here. What are you going to call that? Like, just trying to describe that with functional groups, it's too challenging. So the first thing that we do is we try and identify the longest chain of carbons. So you might have to take a couple guesses to pick the longest one, but sooner or later you'll identify the longest chain. When you encounter your first substituent, you want to prioritize counting that way. So here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. The first substituent is in the 2 position. If we were to instead count from this side, we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. We might decide to give this one the first priority, but because this is in the 2 position and this is in the 3 position, we instead decide to go for the 2 position because that gives us the smaller number. Finally, when you're listing substituents on alkanes, you want to list them in alphabetical order, the same way that we did for the benzene ring. So here you can see we have 2, 5, 6, 7 tetramethyl nonane, or nonane if you prefer. Now we're going to look at a couple more complex examples. So here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So that's the heptane backbone. In the 2 position, we have a methyl group. In the 3 position, we have an ethyl group. And in the 6 position, we have the bromo group. But because bromo starts with a B, we're going to list that one first. Hence why we go B for bromo, E for ethyl, M for methyl in that order. To make sure that our numbering is done in the right order, we add up the sum of the substituents. This is how I had suggested this works for the aromatic ring case. Here you can see we're just adding up the prefix number for each of the substituents. 6 plus 3 plus 2 equals 11. If we were to instead number from the opposite side and go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, the bromine would be 2, the ethyl would be 5, the methyl would be 6. 2 plus 5 plus 6 equals 13, and therefore this one's wrong because 11 is a smaller number than 13. So if you ever are unsure about what the correct chain to make the primary chain is, you can try numbering it a couple different ways and then add up the sum of the substituents to get an indicator. As I was mentioning earlier, though, most of the time we would just convert structure to name because it's semantics, literally. So if we have alkenes or alkynes in molecules, they take priority for the numbering over substituents in the backbone. So in this case, you give the prefix of the entire alkene at the beginning of it. If there's multiple alkenes, you'd list all of them at the beginning. So in this case, we have our entgegen, our opposite alkene, which is just a trans alkene. The E is just used for like precision, for consistency. Here you can see we number from the left to right, even though we have a bromine in one carbon over from the right side, because the alkene takes priority, we number from left to right so that the alkene gets the smaller number. In the case of the alkyne, it works the exact same way, but because we can't have different geometries of alkynes, there's no prefix given the same way that there is in the case of olefins. So some good practice questions for next lecture are shown here. We'll go through these at the start of next lecture. Some of these can be confusing, so we'll see how you guys do. Thank you for watching. If you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comment section. If you like the video, give it a like, and if you want to see more of these videos, you can subscribe. And as always, I'm open to any feedback you have about the content of this channel moving forward. Thank you.